So this is going to be a demonstration of the duodenum and some related structures which are right next to it. We can see there's a stomach here which has been cut open. So let's start off from the pyloric sphincter here. This is the pyloric sphincter, and we can see the pyloric sphincter is thick muscle. Immediately after the pyloric sphincter is this portion here, which is relatively smooth, free from any mucosal folds. This is the first part of the duodenum, or the superior part of the duodenum, which is at the level of L1, which has been opened out. Then we have this portion of the duodenum, which is the descending portion of the duodenum, which is from L1 to L3. Then we have this portion of the duodenum, which is at the level of L3. This is the horizontal part of the duodenum. And finally, we have the last part of the duodenum, which goes from L3 to L2. And at the TJ flexure, duodenojejunal flexure, from the retroperitoneal, it becomes the intraperitoneal jejunum. And this is the cut portion of the jejunum. So this is the TJ flexure. So these are the parts, four parts of the duodenum. I would like you to notice this fibromuscular structure, which is attached to the duodenojejunal flexure. This is that fibromuscular structure I was referring to. This is referred to as the suspensory ligament of Treitz. This holds up the TJ flexure. It runs up, it goes behind the pancreas, which we can see here. This is the pancreas, and from under the pancreas, it gets attached to the right crest of the diaphragm. The next thing I would draw your attention to are the mucosal folds inside the duodenum. The first inch of the first part of the duodenum is intraperitoneal. This is also referred to as the duodenal cap or the duodenal ampulla in radiology. And that is also the most common site of duodenal ulcer. Apart from the first part, which I told you is relatively free from mucosal folds, we can see from the second part onwards, the duodenal folds are transverse. And they are going all the way to the third part and to the fourth part, which we have cut it open here to show the fourth part of the duodenum here. We also notice that the duodenum is quite dilated. And yet one more thing I will draw your attention to is where my finger has gone in. This is papilla of Vater, which is very dilated in this particular patient. Normally it is not so big. And here we can see my probe has gone into the head of the pancreas. And not only that, when I turn the probe up, we can see that it is coming to the common bile duct here. This is the common bile duct. And we can see the common bile duct is coming from the porta hepatis, and it is entering through the head of the pancreas, which we have split open. And it is meeting with the main pancreatic duct, and they are all opening here in the papilla of Vater, the main pancreatic duct. This is at the second part of the duodenum, and this marks the junction between the midgut and the foregut. The next thing which I would like to draw your attention to is duodenal diverticulum. This is one huge duodenal diverticulum that this patient had, and we can see my finger is inside the duodenum and it has gone into the diverticulum. This patient also had another duodenal diverticulum, which we can see here. So this patient had multiple duodenal diverticulum, and in this connection, I would like to remind you that there is a syndrome called the Lemmel syndrome, where a large duodenal diverticulum can compress the common bile duct and can produce obstructive jaundice. I don't know whether this patient had Lemmel syndrome or not, but that is a clinical entity. So obviously this patient had quite a few abnormalities. That brings me to the arterial supply of the pancreas, head of pancreas and the duodenum. To bring you up to speed, this is the celiac trunk. The celiac trunk is giving rise to the largest branch, which is the splenic artery. The second largest branch, common hepatic artery. The third branch, left gastric artery. So from the common hepatic artery, we can see this artery coming out. This is the gastroduodenal artery. The gastroduodenal artery runs behind the first part of the duodenum. And we can see it coming here. And after that, it gives rise to this branch here. This is the right gastroepiploic, and it gives rise to the next branch here. This is the superior pancreatic or duodenum. And to see the same thing again from this side, we can see the superior pancreatic or duodenum and the right gastroepiploic. From the hepatic artery proper, we can see right gastric artery coming out, and it runs in the lesser curvature. Now I will lift up the head of the pancreas from the C loop of the duodenum, and I will show you the superior mesenteric artery. This is the superior mesenteric artery, and just to the right of the superior mesenteric artery is the superior mesenteric vein. And we can see coming from the superior mesenteric artery is this artery here. This is the inferior pancreaticoduodenal. And we can see the other portions of the inferior pancreaticoduodenal here also. Inferior pancreaticoduodenal runs from below, and the superior pancreaticoduodenal runs from above. And they form an anastomotic arcade in this region. And they supply both the head of the pancreas as well as the C-loop of the duodenum. That is why whenever there is any cancer of the head of the pancreas, which is not very uncommon, we cannot separately dissect them out. So we have to do what is known as pancreaticoduodenectomy, also called the Whipple's procedure, which is a very extensive procedure. So these are some of the structures which I wanted to show you in the C-loop of the duodenum, the head of the pancreas, the blood supply, and some abnormalities in this particular case, namely the duodenal diverticulum. Thank you very much for watching. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Have a nice day.